Seriously, guys, where am I?
I told you the whole way over here that we're not telling you.
Emmy, just shut up and breathe.
When can I take this stupid bond mode off?
Right now.
Song.
And you sounded fantastic playing it.
Emmy, I was hoping that you might go to prom with me.
Of course I will. You could have texted me and I would have said yes.
Yeah, but I thought you were worth more than that. Emmy, I was hoping that you might go out with me.
We go out all the time.
No, but I was hoping that you would be my girlfriend.
Of course I will.
Hey, have y'all thought any more about going to prom?
No, because I don't have nobody to go with.
Same. No one asked me to go. I have this beautiful dress. Shame for it to go to waste.
Why don't we all just go together?
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
We don't have to make a big deal out of anything.
Y'all, we can literally go to Chick-fil-A, go to the park, free game, if you know.
Right.
And then we can go to prom, have a good old time, and then we can just do whatever we want.
Ooh, right. So basically, like, every other Saturday, just a formal
way. Exactly. Like, no parents, no nothing.
Right.
No drama.
Please.
When we get ready.
You guys are cosmetology kids. Just get ready here.
Ooh, that's a good idea.
Yeah. What do y'all dresses look like?
Mine's pink.
Mine's green and white.
Mine's pink.
Mine's blue.
That's pretty.
Good.
Yes.
Can we take your car?
As long as you drive. I'm not driving.
Of course. Make the stoner the DD.
Duh. <That's funny. laughs>
I get it. Nobody wants a DUI.
Hey, guys. Why don't we look on Pinterest so we can find some hairstyles and I can help y'all?
That's good. That's,
yeah. Yeah. Let's do that.
I feel like that's awesome. That'd be a good idea.
Man, I mean, I look good, obviously, but these pants are just a little big, don't you think?
No, you look fine.
Yeah, it looks great.
So good.
Y'all aren't even paying attention. They're literal clown pants.
Clowns look great. What?
If I was a clown, I would look good, you know, but these, they're just big, you know?
They're fine.
I step on them when I walk, Coda. Anywhere, where's Cutter? Cutter's taking forever, dude.
All right, I'm ready.
Come on, show
up. Right, how do I look?
Oh, you look
yes,
tough.
Yes, fire.
Are you sure?
Trust us, we're your friends.
I mean, you're going to be the second best looking there, of course. I mean, because I'm there, you mean? I'm the first, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Never forget pants. You. Dude, we already talked about this. The pants are big, but we can get them fixed. The lady out there told me she would fix them for me.
Weren't you the one that said you look like a clown?
I did. All right, we're going to stop talking about me now.
I think I look.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, you really can't beat this place. This is $99 for a prom tux.
That is facts. And I mean, I'm on a budget, you know what I mean? Because, you know, I just started that new job or whatever.
Yeah.
But, Jaren, did you text Maddie about the drinks or whatever?
Yeah, I can only get booze.
What type of booze? Like vodka? I mean, that's fine. Goodness. I don't drink vodka a lot.
Well, we better get going then, because y'all remember what happened last time we were late.
Yeah.
It's not my fault I was trying to sleep. I wasn't trying to make you listen to my giggle fits again.
Yeah, absolutely not.
Yeah, I'm not trying to sit through one of those again. All right, I got to get changed.
Okay.
All right, let's go.
Me and Amber just chill whenever we smoke. Just make sure it's good. Last time I greened out, and that was not fun, dude.
Greening out is not fun. I mean, you're chilling when you're drunk, too, both of y'all.
It's fine. Those who want to drink can drink, and those who want to smoke can smoke. It's a win-win for everyone except Cutter.
Thanks so much for coming in, guys.
Of course, of course. Yeah.
No, thank you. Not everybody can just deal with obnoxious teenagers.
Who's obnoxious?
You.
You. Literally you.
Do you think I'm obnoxious?
No. You are fine. We're glad to help.
Yeah. Yep, thanks. You saved our bank accounts and got us shipped out ready for prom.
Facts.
Yeah. Well, be sure to send us pictures.
We'll do.
Yeah,
we'll do. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, bro, I'm gonna look so freaking good.
I'm gonna look better than
you.
You're
not really good.
You're
basically
gonna look better.
I'm
gonna look better.
That is.
I promise you, my parents.
Oh my gosh, you guys. I can't believe prom is already here. And Becca's stressing so bad to find a dress.
I told you, Amber, you should have waited till the last second to go shopping.
Yeah, I know. I'm just really horrible when it comes to planning for stuff like this.
Yeah, well, unlike you, I've had my dress picked out for months.
Okay, well, I'm looking for a red dress. What color did you guys go with?
Wait, a red dress? Well, you're gonna have to choose a different color, because I'm wearing a red dress.
What are you gonna do about it?
Nothing.
Well, mine's pink, so don't get a pink one.
Yeah, yeah.
Mine's just a simple black dress.
Of course it is.
Shocker.
Okay, well, it's not my fault I look good in black, but this pink one is really pretty, and it's tempting me.
Looks like Pepto-Bismol.
I know you're wanting a red dress, but what about this blue one?
Oh my god, I love it. What do you guys say? Should I try it on?
Yes!
Yes!
Okay, color. Okay.
Where are y'all gonna be sitting?
Just right next to the window.
Alright. Oh, that's... So, are you guys still coming to my house before prom?
Yes! I can't wait!
I still have to see if I can come, but I'm sure I'll be able to.
I'll be there! Good, because I need to see how much alcohol the guys need to bring.
Alcohol?
Yeah, people drink before prom all the time.
Yeah, don't be a baby.
I agree. You just need to chill out for once. It'll be fine.
Are you sure we should be drinking?
Yeah, so?
Are we going to the theater before prom to take pictures?
It's vodka. She wanted to be able to smell it.
Vodka? You know I hate vodka. You know I only drink Fireball.
Well, that's all the guys can bring.
Well, I don't even like vodka, so I'll probably just be smoking.
Really? Drinking and smoking now?
Yeah, what's the big deal? It'll be fine.
I just don't want to get caught doing something stupid like that. Cutter just got accepted into his dream school, and I don't want to risk him losing his chance.
Well, I guess Cutter's gonna have to be the designated driver, and he'll have to stay sober.
Well, since I'm just smoking, I can also drive, because we can't all fit in Cutter's car.
Yeah, then I'll ride with you, and Ryan can come as well.
Yeah, and since I don't have a car, and neither does Jaren, we'll be riding with you and Cutter.
I'm sure that'll be fine. Amber, are you ready to come show us the dress?
Hurry yeah, hurry,
Amber,
come on.
Come on.
Okay, guys.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
I love it.
Guys, I think I just said yes to the dress.
That was really corny.
Have y'all got all of y'all stuff together for prom and everything, like makeup and dresses and all that?
My dress is at school waiting on me.
Oh, so y'all did leave them there Friday?
Yeah,
okay, yeah,
I
that's
did.
A smart
did
plan.
You?
Yeah, I did.
Okay.
Yeah, that's good.
What about y'all's makeup? Y'all bring
yeah,
it to
I have all my
or?
Makeup with me right now, so we can.
I don't usually wear makeup for prom. It's just, I go like natural.
You
just do
something simple? Yeah,
yeah exactly. Yeah.
What are y'all drinking?
I am drinking me some Malibu.
Ooh. I'm drinking a screwdriver.
Ooh, I've never heard of that before.
It's
I'm
really good.
A little Fireball.
Dang.
Girl.
I've had that one.
Girl, your throat.
Wait,
you better not puke in my car. I'll tell you right now. You better not puke
Trust
in my
me,
car.
Trust me, I got you. But do y'all know where Skylar is?
She's your cousin.
I have no clue. I haven't seen her or heard from her. She hasn't texted me.
I see
anything.
Her.
I got the good.
Yeah, we know.
Oh my
what
gosh.
You got?
I got.
Nice.
No. Are these the good snacks?
Yeah, so good.
Okay, good. Okay.
Good.
We
want to get like we want to get that.
They
so.
Should be.
Dang.
Try as long as you say, I believe you. Girl,
those taste so.
Oh my god.
Oh my
god.
Did you get your hair cut?
Yeah, I did.
It looked
oh
good.
My god!
So good.
I didn't notice it just now.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of regretted getting short, but because you know my hair used to be long, I miss my long hair, you know.
It
but hey,
good
I grew back,
you.
So
it
you
looks
know.
Really good short.
Oh, yeah, it is just hair.
Have you tried any different styles with it?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, I put my hair up like you know, like when you take some hair up and pull it back. and like put like little ponytails like, and hair down. Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Or you could do bubble braids.
Right.
Like,
she should take a straightener, straighten her hair, and
I have straightened like, it sometimes. Yeah. Like, my mom's gonna look like Velma.
She looks like Velma.
Yeah, that's what my mom says. She's like, do like maybe for like Halloween or something, do Velma, you know?
Uh-huh. That'd yeah. be cute.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
That would be
good
cute.
These are good. Like,
oh my gosh.
I'm just, so I'm just gonna do I think I'm already
good. Starting. He's gonna like, how much or you know, in him? Cause I'm trying to get, you know.
Messed up.
Just eat like.
Cause, but we also need to pace ourselves.
Eat like six.
I thought the rule is with like pot cookies. I thought the rule was like, you know, like they only take it a little bit so you won't get too high.
It depends on how much is in them.
Yeah. All right, got you.
But are y'all's tolerance is good? Like
mine is. I've been doing this since I was. We ain't even gonna mention.
I just started, so you know, I'm not used you to probably quite yet.
We ain't even gonna chill. Talk about me, y'all.
Yeah, we ain't gonna talk about you, homie. We know about you.
I'll chill on it. I'll chill.
So after we left GT down there, we went over to Costco and picked up a bunch of stuff because they got the prom coming up.
After prom, I'm here at my prom. Had on a nice black suit. I even have me a cane.
A pimp cane?
If you want to call it a pimp, pimp cane. Pimp
what, what about the fuzzy hat? Yeah, that. Yeah, I didn't go to prom. I was busy setting up the after party.
You didn't go to your prom? The after party? You got to go to prom first. Then you go to the after party.
I'm not a dancer.
Say, I am, so. Oh, it is prom this weekend, isn't it?
It is, it's coming up.
Oh, man, I sure hope these kids behave and don't go crazy out there. I hope we can have a bunch of teenagers out here running around and hopefully not acting crazy.
I hope not, I hope they're smart about it. It's been quiet all day, so hope it doesn't get crazy tonight.
There you go, saying the Q word. It's been a good- good day so far, and you got to drop the key.
Adam 3, Adam 4, can you copy on the 9-10 boundary?
Here it is. Yep.
Adam
3,
Adam 4. Got a report of accident with entrapment. Multiple patients, 1,000 South Highway there, Bradley Hospital. An accident with entrapment, multiple patients involved, 3 cars.
Passing the ticket. Got it coming around.
Oh! Covered up. Mikey, why there, Mikey? Why? 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 Why?
Wait for me to tell you this.
Tell me what? What's wrong?
Aiden was in a crash.
No, he wasn't.
He was.
No, where is he? No.
He crashed at Bradley High School. And
well, hold on. Let me get my keys and we'll just go. Like, why are we here? I need to get to him. Like, hold on a second.
Amber.
What?
There's nowhere to go.
What do you mean there's nowhere to go, Mikey?
Aiden passed away.
No.
I did everything I could. I was the first one there and I tried.
Mikey, what do you mean? Like, no, there's no way. Not Aiden, not my child. No.
It was Aiden. I've known him.
No.
I've known him his whole life.
Are you sure? There's no way.
I'm positive it was Aiden.
I
was there with him.
I need to go there. Can you take me?
No.
Please?
There's nowhere to go.
No. I've got to go. I have to go.
There's nowhere to go.
What are we going to do? Why are we standing here? What do you mean?
Amber, he's gone.
Knock, knock.
What's up,
What's
coach?
What's up, coach?
What's up, guys?
How are you?
I'm good. Am I interrupting?
Nah, yes, you're good.
Let's go get some coffee and let them right. Come through chat.
We'll be back. Cool.
We'll be out of here. It's good to see you, coach.
We'll see y'all in a minute. What's up, man?
What's up, coach?
How you feeling?
Not great.
Not great? Yeah. So how you processing, man? You just now kind of coming to. Where's your head at, brother?
Not good, coach. Pretty rough right now.
Yeah? Yeah. Man, between wrestling and piano and girlfriends, there's a lot, you know, a lot of questions probably going through your mind right now. Some frustration, some anger, stuff like that. So,
yeah.
Have you heard from anybody? You know, as far as schools related. You know, obviously, you know, Ethan, friends, Eddie, yeah. Everybody's been here. But, you know, where are you at? It's just me and you. Like, where are you at?
Well, I mean, a lot of people have supported me right now, so that's been good.
Right.
I'm just stuck right here right now, so right. That kind of sucks.
I won't keep you too long, man. I know you're processing, and you got tons of people here to see you. They all let me kind of come in front of them, but you know, just on the transactional side of things, you got to look at, you know, what you've done. You know, coming through to all your state medals to your state championships and everything you've come through. So, you know, God's put that in your path for a reason to show you what you can do. And then, you know, on the transformational side of things, you know, this is one of those Romans 8:28 situations, you know. All things work together for the good of those who love Him and those who have been called for a purpose. So for whatever reason, God's allowed this to happen to you. You know, He could have stopped it 100%, you know, and He didn't. So you're going to have to look at what you could have controlled in that situation with your friends and learn something from that, but also just pray and ask for, you know, what's the purpose of which this has happened and what has He called you to use that for? And so I know that's a lot to deal with. That's a lot of heavy stuff for an 18-year-old young man, but I'm going to be here with you and I'm going to pray through it with you. And that's just kind of what you need to keep, in my opinion, what you would need to keep focusing on. So that's just where I'm at with it, man. I'm sorry. But I know you. You know, I know you well. I know you better than probably what most people do. And if anybody can handle the situation, it's Luke Belcher.
What am I going to do, Coach? I mean, where do I go from here?
Well, you know, I mean, this is a pretty bad thing, but there's a lot worse things in life that can happen. And if this is the worst thing that can happen, even though it's up there, it's still not that bad of a thing. But as far as college and wrestling is concerned, man, all those things are temporary anyways. You know, they're just a means to an end to a certain extent. But, you know, again, going back to Scripture, Romans 8:28, like, it's called you to this for a purpose, you know, and if He's brought you to it, then maybe He's wanting you to look to Him to try to figure out how to get through it. But, you know, on the earthly side of things, man, like, if, you know, there's people that have won state titles and done amazing things on a wrestling mat with far worse conditions, you know, but on the business side of it might hamper your future. But that's why it's great to be a student before an athlete, you know, and the fact that, you know, if that door shuts, another one will open. And as long as you've prayed about where you're supposed to be, if that's in the center of God's will, man, He's going to take you where you need to be. But, you know, I mean, it's nothing that you really need to worry about right now. That stuff will all sort itself.
Hey, Mikey, thanks for coming in today, man. I understand that you were the responding officer on that crash a couple days ago with the local high school students. Man, how are you?
I mean, I guess as good as I could be right now, to be honest with you. It's kind of weighing on me a little bit.
I'm sure, I can't imagine. When you got to the scene, with the crash, what did you see when you got there?
You know, I work crashes every day as part of my job. It's just something when you roll up and there's three cars involved and you hear people screaming and yelling for help, and you know, you look over and you see one of the students, because I knew they were Bradley students from where the location was, and pulled up and there's a student out there whose arm's so damaged that if I didn't rush over when I did and put the tourniquet on, you know, he wouldn't be here right now. Probably the part that's probably hit me the most is looking over into one of the other cars and seeing, you know, a kid named Aiden that I literally go to church with every Sunday, him and his date in there, and, you know, not moving, not talking, and knowing I gotta focus on the others. And I can't get to them right then and there, you know, so it's kind of hard to describe. There's just so much going on, and, you know, I'm still trying to process everything in my mind about what all happened out there.
Yeah. What were your feelings that you had as you were putting that tourniquet on and knowing that the other young people were in the other vehicle?
The feeling of I'm only one person, and I ain't gonna lie, kind of feeling of, you know, helplessness, because I know I've got so much I need to do, but I can only focus on one person at a time, and the guilt starts hitting me to where maybe if I could have got to the other ones in the car soon enough, maybe they'd still be here right now. Yeah. You know, in my mind, I just keep playing it back as there's something more that I could have done to help everybody out there, and in my mind, it keeps playing over, what more could I have done? What more could I have actually put forward to save somebody that was out there at that crash? And you know, that's probably the hardest part.
Yeah. What are those moments that you go back and play in your head?
As far as that crash when I was out there, just thinking, I know EMS was a long way away, and I only have so much training, and that's the downside of it is I only know so much to try to save somebody's life, and it's like the feeling of guilt and just dread knowing that I know the people inside those cars and there's nothing I can do at all to save them. And that's, I can't even start to describe how this makes me feel empty, like, what am I doing this job for if I can't save somebody?
With guilt and these feelings, of all the things that you've seen regarding this accident, different things can come into our life that might cause us not to take good care of ourselves. How are you sleeping?
Sleep? I kind of don't know what that is right now. Because every time I close my eyes, I see their faces.
Yeah.
I hear their screams, and I smell the smell of the crash, and it was out there, and the faces just keep popping in my head each time I close my eyes, and that's probably one of the worst things is I don't want to sleep, because I know if I sleep I got to relive that all over again.
Yeah.
So it's tough.
Yeah. Getting sleep is very useful to us, to the body, of when there's stress and traumatic things that we've experienced. As hard as that may be, getting the body some rest is a big thing. And I know, with you, this isn't the first time that we've discussed this. I know that part of your job is that you work crash scenes. And I know you've dealt with this many, many times. And when you respond to a scene, it probably triggers a lot of emotions and a lot of previous events in your mind, and you wear that like pretty close.
It's every day. Go to those crashes, and you see young kids laying there, and knowing that something could have prevented that. Something could have, I relate these crashes every day. I've been 16 years I've been doing this job, and not one crash gets any easier. To know that now, not only myself, but his parents have to remember him longer than he's been alive. That, he had all those kids, that's just, the future was so far ahead of them. They had so much to go on, and one simple little mistake cost them everything.
If there's anything you could tell them, what would it be?
If anything, just think twice. Think twice about it. And remember, when you do stuff and you make decisions, you're not only affecting yourself, but everybody else too. Your family, your friends, every decision that they made, I know we kind of live in a world now where it's just all about me. But if they could have stopped and took a second to think, decision I'm making right now, how's it going to affect the other people in my life? And I think if they could have stopped and thought about that, they'd be here right now.
Jamie, and I'm one of the funeral directors here at Companion, and we'll be taking care of your family.
I'm Jamie.
And you are?
I'm Leslie.
Leslie. And you're the mother.
Mm-hmm.
I'm terribly sorry for your loss. I know this can be a hard time for the family.
Yeah.
I'm going to do my best to take care of you.
Thank you so much.
Sir?
Barrett.
Father?
Yes.
Terribly sorry for the loss.
Thank you.
I just have some basic paperwork that we need to start out with and take care of things. Do you have a certain type of service that you're thinking about?
This is all new to us. This is something we had.
Not
prepared. We never prepare for this.
We have everything here from cremation all the way up to a full service burial. I have the price list out here. Most people will do the burial, and those prices start out at $4,995.
I don't know where we're
going to
get the money.
Yeah. I'm terribly sorry. There's, you know, we have some different options here at the funeral.
You do?
We can do to help families. And I understand that this is unplanned, and it's tough. You know, life's tough anyway with the economy and, you know, the way that you basically have your life set up.
Mm-hmm.
Things. I couldn't even imagine where you are right now. Myself being a father, and I have two kids of my own, I couldn't fathom having to do this.
It's the worst nightmare ever.
I'm so terribly sorry.
Thanks.
But we can talk about this now. I do have some basic paperwork that I need to go over with you. Okay. And then but I had to do this part, and I so much apologize about talking about price up front.
That's okay.
But it's necessary to know what direction we're going to go to best take care of your family. Okay. So I'm just going to ask you some basic questions for the death certificates. This is what we call vital information that we gather for the death certificates. Do you know how many death certificates you're going to be needing?
How many do we? As you can imagine, this is totally unexpected. No one ever expects to lose their child. No, sir. Is there a certain number? I mean, you're going to have to walk us through this. It's just devastating.
It's hard, sir. It really is. And the answer is there's no true number. I mean, it's death certificates are designed to take care of things when people pass away, like bank accounts and property and different things like that. Did you have a cemetery plot or a family plot or anything that we could use for a burial if we decided to do it?
I don't know that we're. I don't want her to be buried. Okay. She didn't like the dark.
We're thinking about cremation.
Okay. Well, we can definitely take care of you with the cremation. So, doing a cremation, some of the stuff I need to know outside of the death certificate information that we've already discussed. We have to do this legal document for authorization of the cremation. And I'm going to ask you some questions that truly do not have right or wrong answers, okay? But I have to go through this procedure to make sure that we have everything correct. Did she arrange for her own cremation on a pre-need basis within the funeral home? And I'm sorry, I realize that she's very young and wouldn't have been thinking about that. And in your mind, I'm sure that you realize that or think that she would have been taking care of your arrangements at this point. So these questions are going to sound horrible, but I'm so sorry, but I do have to ask them. Did she leave a will with written instructions to be cremated?
No.
Did she leave will instructions with anyone to be cremated?
No.
All right. This next part I have to ask you, and I do apologize. I always take a little pause right here before I ask this, because just going back yes and no, this can be like a ton of bricks when I ask you this.
Okay.
Is there anyone that you know of that wishes to witness her body being placed into the combustion chamber?
Is that a requirement?
Yes, sir. Well, it's not a requirement, but it is your right. So I have to ask if anyone wants to be present when that happens.
No.
So what I'm going to need for y'all to do is I need you to sign here, right on this bottom, and this is a care track form, and it also stands for authorization form for cremation. This barcode here was placed on her body as soon as she entered our facility. Every time that it is moved into any point in the facility, it's scanned, so it's time stamped, so we know where that she's being moved to. So I'm terribly sorry. All right, so I need each one of you to sign as the mother and the father. And this is going to give us the full permission and authority to perform her cremation. And you're also waiving your rights to see her. And I do believe, due to the traumatic nature, that it would be best to be that way. Now, with the cremation, we can do a basic cremation where everything is returned to you in a basic urn. So this is the type of box that she would return to you in. And inside of this cardboard, is the plastic container. Now she will be sealed up in this, in a plastic bag that goes inside. There will be a medallion with her that goes with her through the whole process, so we know that her remains are true and legitimate. And she will be sealed into this and then placed into that cardboard container. We call this an industry standard because if you did decide to purchase another urn like this one, it fits right inside of it.
Okay. I just thought she'd be just in that little box.
Yeah, you can actually purchase these, but they can be quite expensive. We do have a vendor for those, and there's a whole catalog to be able to look and see what you want to do.
We don't have to do that today, do we?
No, you don't, okay. Sir. You don't. You don't have to make that decision today. So normally, once we get all the arrangements taken care of, the state of Tennessee says they have to give us a permit. So we have to wait approximately 7 to 10 business days for that permit to come. Now, you've signed the authorization, so once the permit gets here, we will have performed the cremation. You're going to receive 2 phone calls from the funeral home. One notifying you the cremation is complete, and that she's ready to be picked up and returned home. The other one will be for her death certificates when they're ready to pick those up. So I'm sure you all got some first. So if y'all want to come back and we can talk to the secretary outside and set up an appointment for a follow-up. Get this in mind. I want you to go ahead and take this price list with you and find out what options. And I know money's a concern, and I know this is unplanned.
Yeah.
I mean, how in the world could you plan for something like this?
Thank you.
All right. I'll have them here for you. My name's Jamie. I'll make sure that you got my card when we walk out, and you're going to have my email and my cell phone. If y'all need anything at all, feel free to call me, okay?
Okay.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you, Jamie.
Take this with you.
Yes.
Letters on the sky, burning in your eyes. You look at me, babe, I wanna kiss.
My dearest Luke, first of all, I want you to know how amazingly special you are and how hard this is for me. I have tried several times to talk to you about this in person, but I just can't make myself say the words. I'm so sorry I'm only 17, and the things you're going through, I can't even begin to understand. You need more than I can possibly give you. Please don't hate me. This is the hardest thing I've ever done. If you want to talk, please call me. I don't leave for Knoxville for another 2 weeks. Please take care of yourself and know that you will find the right person for you. I will always love you, Amy.
Lovers in the night, though it's trying to ride, we don't know how to rhyme, but down we...
Stay right before that mic.
Mr. Miller, you need to be arraigned today on 2 counts of vehicular homicide by intoxication. Are you aware of the allegations, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All going. How do you plead today?
Your Honor, Mr. Miller enters a plea of not guilty. I'll be entering that on his behalf. Attorney Leon Shahan with the Bradley County Bar. I'll be going down as attorney of record for Mr. Miller today.
General Crump, do you wish to be heard on bond?
I do, Your Honor. We have two dead people whose lives have been snuffed out by the actions of this defendant. We would ask for a $250,000 bond.
Mr. Shahan?
Your Honor, while the general is correct, the bond is something that would be required in this case. If you look at the Tennessee Constitution, it does also require that the bond be a reasonable bond. It's something the defendant could reasonably obtain, and not only to guarantee the safety of the community, but also secure his presence in court. At this time, we would ask that bond be lower, given the fact that he is an 18-year-old high school student.
Under law, I do have to set a bond, but I don't. The factor of compelling the presence in court is not the only one. Public safety is an important one, and this is very serious charges. Are you aware of that, sir?
Yes, sir.
If you were to get out on bond, could you abstain from drug use?
Yes, sir.
I am going to set the bond at $200,000 today. I'm going to put down a condition on bond that there be no drug use. You will have to submit to drug testing while you are out on bond. But that is the bond that I'm going to set today. I'm going to set this case for a hearing within the next 2 weeks.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Just step up to the mic.
All right, Ms. Burns, you need to be arraigned today on one count of vehicular assault by intoxication. Are you aware of that allegation?
Yes, sir.
Why are you smiling? This is a serious charge, ma'am. How do you plead today?
Your Honor, Ms. Burns pleads not guilty. I will be entering that plea on her behalf. Attorney Leon Shahan from the Bradley County Bar will be going down as attorney of record for her today.
Does the state wish to be heard on bond?
I do, Your Honor, and I think that the defendant's demeanor here today says a lot about exactly why we're here. Because of this defendant's actions, we had a state champion wrestler who no longer has an arm. He was also a classically trained pianist. And this defendant shows up this morning, and it's all smiles and giggles. Your Honor, I think that this defendant should be remanded without bond. However, the Constitution wouldn't allow it. So I would ask for the same bond that we would normally do on a vehicular homicide of $200,000.
Your Honor, while I'm not giving any excuses for my client's demeanor here today, I would simply point out that that does show a lack of maturity on her part. She is an 18-year-old high school student. And while though she may not quite understand the extreme gravity of the situation today, I think in time she is going to. And understand that she very well may be going to prison for the next 2 to 4 years because of her actions. And I would ask the court to allow her to have a bond that she could reasonably make so that her immature self might understand more the gravity of the situation and be able to defend against this case.
I agree with the general that I find her demeanor to be very troubling, to say the least. This is a serious issue. Sounds like someone's life will be changed forever by what happened on that night. Ms. Burns is entitled to a bond. I'm going to set her bond. This is not a felony, this is a serious felony. I'm going to set the bond at $150,000 today. Do you think you'll be able to make that bond?
Yes, sir.
When you make that bond, there needs to be no drug use.
Yes,
you're going to get drug tested on a weekly basis. We're going to set this case for a hearing within the next 2 weeks.
Okay.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, General. Call your next witness.
State calls Michael Westfield.
All right, sir, if you'll raise your right hand, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes, sir.
All right, you may be seated, sir. You may begin, General.
Thank you, Your Honor. Would you state your full name, please?
Michael Westfield.
Mr. Westfield, where are you employed?
The Bradley County Sheriff's Office.
And what do you do there?
I'm part of the traffic investigation team.
How long have you done that?
10 years.
All right. You know the matter we're here about today. Can you describe how you became involved in this crash?
Yes, sir. Got a call from dispatch about a wreck at Bradley High School. Myself and other traffic investigators responded that way, and it ended up being a three-car crash.
Were there serious injuries involved in this crash?
Yes, sir.
Can you describe those for the jury, please?
We actually had two fatalities in that crash, and one party actually suffered a severed arm to where a tourniquet had to be applied.
Were you able, as part of your training and experience, to determine whether or not alcohol or drugs were involved?
Yes, sir.
And can you tell the jury what your observations were about that?
I drove the driver, had the smell of an alcoholic beverage coming from his person. I knew that he was under the age of 21 just because he was a Bradley High School student. And his speech was slurred, and the way he was talking and actually moving led me to believe that he was under the influence of an alcoholic beverage. So.
And did you later have the opportunity to see a lab report in this case?
I did, yes, sir. We were able to draw blood and send it off to the TBI to be tested, and those results came back as a 0.10. 0.10, yes, sir.
Above the legal limit?
Yes, sir.
Were there any other people that you encountered that day that were intoxicated?
One of the other parties in the vehicle, and one of the other vehicles was impaired, but I believe it was more on the lines of being drug impaired instead of alcohol impaired.
All right. Do you see the people in this courtroom today that are responsible for the deaths of those two people and
yes,
the injury of another?
Yes, sir.
Can you point them out for the jury? Your Honor, if the record could reflect that he's identified the two defendants.
He did point right at them. The record will reflect that. All right, ma'am, please raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes, sir.
All right, have a seat for me. General, you may begin.
Thank you, Your Honor. Would you state your full name for the jury, please?
Madison Teague.
Ms. Teague, what do you do?
I'm a student at Bradley Central High School.
Okay. Are you nervous here today?
Yes.
Okay, don't be nervous. All we're looking for is somebody to tell the truth. You understand that?
Yes, sir.
All right. I'm going to ask you if you know a person by the name of Jared Miller.
Yes, sir.
How do you know Mr. Miller?
We used to date.
Okay, all right. As you know, he was involved in a very serious matter that we're here about today. Do you recall that day?
Yes, sir.
Were you with Mr. Miller during that day?
Yes, sir.
At any time while you were with him, did you observe him drinking alcohol?
Yes, sir.
Would you say it was a little or a lot?
A lot.
Do you know exactly how much?
No.
Okay. When he spoke to you, could you tell that something was wrong with his speaking voice?
Yes, sir.
What, could you tell what was wrong with it?
It was just a lot slower.
Okay.
It wasn't really making sense.
Okay. And could you see him walk?
Yes, sir.
Could you tell that anything was wrong with the way he walked?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you tell the jury what was wrong with him?
He just didn't have any balance. He was stumbling.
Okay. So, you were in the car with him when all this happened, right?
Yes, sir.
Do you recall what was happening at the time that the crash occurred?
We were listening to music.
Okay.
And heading to prom.
Okay. And did you see what was going to happen before it happened?
No, sir.
It just happened?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Ms. Hughes, my name is Leon Shahan. I'm an attorney, and I represent the people that are accused of this crime here today.
Yes, sir.
I have some questions for you. Mm-hmm. Those questions may or may not be easy, but they are things that I need to know to be able to understand the truth as to what actually happened.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Mm-hmm. I'm not here to belittle you in any way. I'm not here to attack you in any way. Just ask questions.
Yes.
If I ask any questions you don't understand, can you ask me to repeat them?
Yes, sir.
And you swore under oath to tell the truth here today. Is that
yes,
right?
Sir.
All right. Now, the day this happened, the Saturday of prom.
Yes, sir.
Tell me what you were doing that day and who you were with.
I was with Skylar Burns, and we were with some friends, and we were at Fletcher Park.
Okay. Were you in a vehicle?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Who drove there?
Skylar did.
Okay. And you rode as a passenger?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Was anybody else in the car with you?
We had two other friends with us, I believe. Yes.
Okay. Who were they?
Her name is Abby. I don't know her last name. And then we had a friend named Autumn.
Okay. And about what time did you get to the park?
I'm going to say 1 o'clock.
Which one is it? 1 or 5?
1. 1.
Okay. You would agree with me there's a big difference between 1 and 5, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now, At 1 o'clock, when you're at the park, what are you doing at the park?
We're just hanging out, talking,
just hanging out, talking. Were you drinking?
Yes, sir.
You were? What were you drinking?
Well, I was drinking some Malibu coconut rum.
Okay.
And Skylar was drinking.
I'm not focusing on Skylar right now. I'm focusing on you. What were you drinking?
I was drinking Malibu.
Okay. Were you doing anything else? Any other type of illegal drugs that day?
Yes, sir.
You were? Okay. What were you doing? Eating edible marijuana. How much edible marijuana did you eat?
I don't know how much was in them or, like, I don't know, like, the measurements. But
what do you know?
I do know that I ate a few cookies and some gummies that had marijuana in them.
And then you made the conscious choice to get back in the car and ride with these people after you did that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The reason I'm asking that is because if you remember when you testified on direct examination, you gave a very detailed thing that happened that Mr. Burns did that day, but you left out all the things you did that day, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
Is that an answer? Yes, sir? You would agree with me because you were under the influence. Your testimony here today as a witness is hardly credible. It is incompetent and irrelevant, and you have no business telling what happened, do you, ma'am?
All right, Ms. Burns, you stand before me convicted with a jury finding you guilty of vehicular assault by intoxication. You have forever changed the life of the young man whose arm you took by your actions. It is my job today to sentence you. Your attorney has argued for leniency given your age and immaturity. The state has argued for prison time. In sentencing you today, I have to look at a number of factors. One of those factors is the severity of the crime and whether or not the punishment fits the crime. This is a very severe crime. As I said, the young man involved, the victim here, will forever have his life altered by your actions. And I also am to consider the defendant's demeanor, attitude, and ability to be reformed. And I find that throughout this trial and court experience, you have been cavalier in your attitude. You have been giggling, laughing, smiling, while a young man sits with his life altered forever. Given the severity of the crime and your demeanor and attitude, not appreciating the seriousness of the crime, I feel that it is appropriate to deny a probatable sentence to you. And I am going to be sentencing you to 3 years in the Tennessee Department of Corrections to start immediately today. So, officer, please take Ms. Burns into custody. Please take her into custody. All right. Mr. Miller, you stand before me convicted today of 2 counts of vehicular homicide. You have been convicted by a jury of your peers. 2 lives are no longer here today because of the actions that you took on that day. Your attorney is asking that I sentence you based on your age and immaturity to the least possible sentence I can sentence you, which is 8 years. The state is asking for not the maximum, but for considerably longer than the minimum sentence. I would note that I find your demeanor throughout this process to be contrite, meaning that you are sorrowful for what happened and sorry, truly sorry, for the lives that you took. But I also find that this is a crime that is a very serious crime, obviously. 2 people are no longer here because of you and what you did. Based on that, those 2 balancing factors, I find that the minimum would not be justice. But I also find that the maximum, 24 years, would not be just to sentence you to. So the sentence that I am going to give you is 10 years in the Tennessee Department of Corrections, which is prison. I think that that is a just sentence that would allow you to fully appreciate what you have done and also to be a preventative factor to people who would drive under the influence otherwise. So, sir, you are young. You have your full life ahead of you. when you come out after this serious sentence, let's not ever do it again. Turn your life around. Use this time to better yourself as well. Officer, please take him into custody today.
Hands behind your back.
Put a rose on the sky, burning in your eyes. You look at me, babe, I wanna catch on fire. It's buried in my soul. On behalf of the Olinger family, I wanna say thank you for coming here today to show your support and encouragement to this family in what is an unforeseen event that none of us would have ever thought would take place. Your presence here today not only offers them encouragement, but it shows them love and support, of which they're many going to need throughout the next few days, weeks, and even years. In times like this, it's important for us to depend on not only the comfort from one another, but to depend on the strength that comes from God and God alone. None of us would have ever expected to find ourselves in this place. But even though we are here, thank you.